been starting this 4 years ago, and we are at a point where we can clearly say that the industry at large is backing up segment routing. We have the deployments 4 years after the first PowerPoint presentation across all the segments we were targeting. We have deployments in the large-scale web market. We have deployment in the service provider. We have deployment in the enterprise. But we have deployment in all the part of the networks we wanted to get deployed. We have deployment in data center. We have deployment in the metro, in the large aggregation. We have deployment in the backbone. We have deployment inter-domain, and this in 4 years. So it's a velocity and aggressivity from a productization and deployment viewpoint that I've never seen at Cisco. All the technology is standardized. There is no single bit of proprietary technology, and everything we did has been disclosed. We are maintaining more than 20 drafts at the ATF to ensure the standardization. So I think that it was a clear commitment we made to our operators, to our lead operators. I'll come back to this later on. And I think we have delivered on this. It has become the de facto IP SDN architecture. And we have worked very hard in order to convince and get the multi-vendor consensus. And it was another commitment to our lead operators. So this was mainly that status has been reached by applying the segment routing principle to the MPLS data plane. From a philosophy viewpoint, the idea about segment routing, from the start, I always had it for IPv6. But the MPLS data plane was there, easy to use, obvious, and there was a fantastic opportunity over MPLS. And we will do much more over MPLS over the coming years, so there's still a lot to do. But still, what I want to say is, since the beginning, IPv6 is there. And so this year, we're really starting the SRv6 productization and deployments. Why is it so important over IPv6? Because IPv6 is clear needed from a reachability viewpoint. If we look at the extension of IP networks, we have extensions at the edge with 5G and IoT. It drastically increases the number of things that we need to address to reach. But as well, we have evolution in the data center with the container adoption and the microservices. So same thing, many more things that we need to address. So IPv6 is obvious from a reachability viewpoint. We need bigger address space for the reachability. What are we going to do on top of IPv6? Are we going to do RSVP in order to do fast reroute, in order to do TE? Well, in MPLS world, we had 20 years of complexity to get rid of RSVP for fast reroute and for TE. We've seen it with this fantastic deployment of segment routing MPLS. So no, we are not going to do RSVP on top of IPv6 to do the underlay SLA. What we're going to do is SRv6 to do the underlay. And so this is really the same as what we have been doing over the last 4 years. All the algorithm that we deployed, all the technology we implemented, all of this has been fought for IPv6. The only thing we need to enable it for IPv6 is the IPv6 data plane for segment routing. And so this is the support of a routing extension header for segment routing. In this IPv6 extension header, we're going to have the list of addresses that the packet needs to go through. And as soon as we have this support in the data plane, that's it. All of these functionalities are going to be leveraged for SRv6. And so this is, I think, clear. The key questions we want to ask is that, are we going to stop there? Are we going to do a cake? Like, on top of this, for example, to create VPN, I'm going to add two protocols just to vehicle the information about a VPN ID or a tenant ID? Am I going to add UDP, VXLAN, GRE, L2TP, V3, and all of these things just to express a VPN ID? If I need to do NFV, am I going to define a new protocol, NSH, from scratch just to convey metadata information between my NFZ? So if there is one thing that is clear in the IP history, is that many layers add complexity of operation and is not economical. And so if we have an opportunity to eliminate these layers by doing multiple things with the same protocol, it will always win. And this is our vision. It's bold, but that's our vision. We know it's bold, but we are really committed on it. And we can see that there is a huge traction in the market. It's basically to look at it and say, we're going to eliminate these additional layers by offering a solution that is based on IPv6 and SRv6. Because with these two things together, we have the power to express anything. And our commitment to the lead operators is very strong. Like we did for SRMPLS, the lead operators are key to this work. You will see, I have the picture later on. We met in Rome at the beginning of the year with all the lead operators, the lead academic team, for 4 days from 9 to 6. We reviewed all of the technology, and then a few weeks after, we submitted 4 drafts that define SRv6 at the ATF. So the commitment to the lead operators is clear. The commitment to standardization, everything is out there, which means it's a very big sign for us because it's a lot of research that we have, but we publish it. Across the design, it's very important to focus, like we did for SRMPLS, on the seamless deployment. And I believe that the deployment of SRv6 will be at least as simple as what we have seen for SRMPLS. And imagine, we had the design, the productization, and the deployment in 4 years. So it's extremely fast from a networking deployment cycle viewpoint. And I think SRv6 will be faster than this because the deployment model is at least equivalent from a seamless viewpoint. And then we have a commitment to our lead operators to work on the multi-vendor consensus. We met in Rome. We look at what were the vendors that were important to the community. And you can see through the 4 drafts that we published that we have partners ranging from Ericsson, Arista, Nokia, Barefoot. And you will see that in the coming months, they are going to also show some demonstration of SRv6 capability. I cannot say more at this stage, but we are pretty optimistic to see this multi-vendor consensus that was reached very quickly. So that's the picture in Rome with all of the team, 4 days. I think it's impressive, 4 days from 9 to 6. These are all the people that are co-authoring this work. This is the main document, the network programming document. If there is one document that you need to read, it's this one. It's basically going to be what I described today. And then these are the 3 documents that basically explain how to do VPN over SRv6, how to do traffic engineering and fast reroute over SRv6, and this is the segment routing extension header. So it's this data plane where you have this extension header and where you have the list of addresses. But I'm going to intuitively explain you how we got to this definition, and I think it's simple. The concept is SR for anything, is to look at the network as a big computer. Okay, so first we need a network instruction. And a network instruction is a 128-bit address where we see 2 parts. On the left, we have the locator. On the right, we have the function. We make no restriction on whether it is 64, 80, 48, 48, 80. We make no restriction. But in your mind, for simplicity, you can think 64, 64. The first part is the locator. It will be routed to the device. And once we get to the device that is located by the locator, the rest of the bits identify a function that is going to be executed there. So it's like when you code in C, it's a function call, but not on the local device, at the device located by the locator. When we execute that function, like in C, we can pass arguments with the function call, and these are in this part of the bits in the 128 bit, which we call segment, SRv6 segment. So if we have the concept of a network instruction, define it, then I'm going to define a network program. What is a network program? This is a list of network instructions. So it's a list of SRv6 segments with a pointer that indicates where am I in my program. And so in the beginning of the journey of the packet, I put the first segment into the destination address, and the packet is going to be routed to locator 1. At locator 1, he sees that it's himself, so he can decode the network instruction. He finds in the rightmost bits the function 1, and he executes it. Once he has executed that function, he looks into the segment routing extension header, take the next segment, put it into the destination address, send it through the network. Here is the seamless deployment. For any transit device between locator 1 and locator 2, it's a plain IPv6 packet. They just transit, they forward like IPv6, RFC 2460, defined it 15, 20 years ago. The packet will reach the node 2 identified by locator 2, and only him will understand the rightmost bits, and he will recognize, ah, this is this function. I'm executing function 2, and it can be anything. It can be anything. It could be an hardware device, so more underlay-centric, but it could be as well an NFV, and the function might be the address of identifying a VM or a container. So you have the full compute possibility that is expressed through this function 2 call. Once it is executed, again, the same, we take the next segment, we put it in the destination address, and we send it on the way to node 3 that is identified by locator 3, where function 3 is going to be executed. So that's it. We have a network instruction, which is a segment routing V6 segment. We have a network program, which is a list of segments. Now, if you code in C, you know that when you code, you do function calls, you pass arguments, but you want also to share arguments between functions calls. So we need global arguments. And we put them at the end of the segment routing extension header. This is where you have metadata TLV, where you have performance information, where you have credential user information. And if you were interested in NSH, we have a carrier for any NSH-defined TLV so that you can reuse all the work that was done at the ITF from a NSH metadata viewpoint. You just don't need to use NSH to convey it. You can carry this in the metadata TLV inside SRv6. So now we really have something like a C program. I have my list of instructions, I have my functions call, my local parameters, and my global parameters. What else do I need? I need a tag in order to classify the packets as a group of packets in order to do group-based policy. And that's it. This is exactly the definition of the segment routing extension header as defined it at the ITF. And if you look at it, this has the power of a Turing machine. And so it means we can express anything like a modern computer. I think you got it. The functionality, the expression power is there, but you're going to ask, is it performant? And the answer is yes, because we spent a lot of time through the first implementation that we did 3 years ago, at least of the SRv6, which helped us to learn a lot from how to structure the header. And if you look at the design of this header, there are basically two parts. The first part is focused on the hardware centric. We want to be supported at full rate on the ASIC. And this is for operations that relate to the underlay or the overlay VPN creation, for fast reroute, for TE, for VPN. This will be supported by an implementation on the hardware. It has to be full performance for the hardware. So the header is optimized for the hardware. The rest of the header, the one on the bottom, which would be far to reach for the deep to reach for the hardware, is there designed for the CPU world, for the NFV world. And this is where we're going to place the metadata TLV, like the performance information or the user information. So we managed to design these two uses, to integrate these two uses in the MEM, in the same header, to marry two worlds, the hardware and the software world. And on the performance, I know things that I cannot say now. You'll see this later on in the day, in the year, some of the announcements that will be made. But clearly, the performance for SRv6 will be reached. So I'm going to skip this and focus on the use case, because I think it's so you can have the slides to go more in detail. You can use the slides as a first reading of the draft. It's more illustrated. But let's focus on the use case. So just like for MPLS, when I explain MPLS with segment routing, I always use like some assumptions to make it easy on how to recognize a prefix segment, an adjacency segment, and we always use the same convention. In the draft, in our presentation, all my colleagues, they all use the same terminology, and it is a lot the understanding of the technology. So here, we're going to do the same. And these are conventions. They are not at all a restriction on, obviously, the implementation of the technology, but it's a convention to ease the understanding. And so I'm going to, for example, assume through my terminology that node 1 is going to advertise the reachability to a block A1/64, meaning that if 12 needs to send any packet destined within that block, well, there will be a shortest path through the network from 12 to 1 for the prefix A1/64. Node 5, it would be A5/64. So it's always A, and the node number /64 is the block routed to the node. Okay? So that's the block of segments. Now, this is my locator, but now I need to allocate functions. I'm going to, today to do all my use case with only two functions. And for the NAV, I will bring a few other functions later on. The first functions I'm going to use is the function zero. Just by convention, it's the most basic, so the zero is the endpoint. It's in SRv6 where you come to the node that is identified by the locator, and then you simply take the next segment and you put it in the destination adder. This is really the base to do traffic engineering and fast reroute. So for example, if I have A1:0, if the packet has this destination address, the packet will be forwarded up to node 1. Node 1 will say, ah, I understand this. I take the next segment, I put it in the destination address, and I forward on the shortest path to the next segment. If I want to send to A5:0, it will be routed to the node 5 because it's A5/64. It's the locator for 5. The function ID is 0. This is the most basic function. It's take the next segment, put it in the destination address, and forward along that updated destination address. Now I have the second function, which we call the endpoint with trust connect to a neighbor. So for example, A1:C2 means you need to forward to node 1. And when one receives it, he says, this is my segment, A1:C2. Only me can understand it. And the right part, the function ID, is C2. It means cross connect to node number 2. So it means that when the node 1 receives this packet, he takes the next segment, put it in the destination address, but he doesn't forward according to the updated destination address. He cross-connect the packet to the neighbor number 2. And this functionality is really needed for some cases of traffic engineering and fast reroute, when we want to force the packet to go on a path that would not be the shortest path. Another example, A5:C7. This will lead the packet to node 5. Node 5 will say, ah, this is for me. I can interpret the function. This function ID is C7. What does it mean? Update the next segment into the destination address, but don't forward according to it. Cross connect to node number 7. OK, great. Now we have our base terminology. First use case. And this is Satoru-san is in the room. He's one of the lead operators at SoftBank, lead architect. He's very interested in these two first use cases I'm going to go through. So these use cases are first about fast reroute and TE. So applying SRv6 in the underlay, just doing the same as what we were doing in SIMPS, but with the vision that the networks are becoming all IPv6. And so from a simplicity viewpoint, if you can eliminate one layer here in PLS, you always gain simplicity. And so TILFA, we invented it 3-4 years ago. All the research has been done in terms of algorithmic development. What is it? It's an ISIS OSPF algorithm that allows the router to compute in advance of the failure the backup path for each destination. Destination one at a time. Each different destination has an optimized backup. And so this pre-computation is done so that we load the data plane with this backup path, and when the failure occurs, we're able to switch on the backup path in sub 50 milliseconds. This algorithm works for link protection, node protection, and SRLG protection. It is mathematically proven to work in any topology. There's no need for human beings to optimize the topology. It's mathematically proven. Not only this, it computes the backup path to be the post-convergence path, which from a capacity viewpoint is the best path you can think of. So it's why we say it's an optimum backup path. So when, and then it allows for incremental deployment because it's a node-by-node behavior. This, we did it 3-4 years ago from a research viewpoint. We did it as an implementation viewpoint 3 years ago. We started to deploy it 2 years ago. So it's vastly shipping and deployed. But as soon as we have the SRv6 data plane, that's it. Because all the research has been done for IP. It's only at the last moment that we were translating the IP segment into MPLS segment because this was the data plane we had. But all of this technology is readily available for SRv6. And so how would it work? To remind a bit how this go, if I have a packet that goes to node 5, this goes to A5 function 0, I'm node number 6, what is my primary path? My primary path is 2.5. And so I use my ISIS algorithm to compute if the primary link would fail, what would be the backup path? The backup path would be to go via 2 and through this very bad link 2.4. But I cannot simply send back the packet because the network is not aware about the failure. So I need to force the packet to go to 2 and especially through the link 2.4. And you have understood. I simply use this segment, go to the endpoint and cross-connect. I can express this with simply the segment A2 colon colon C4. So let's see this in action. The link fails. I receive packets. I immediately fast reroute by injecting a single segment A2 colon colon C4. Once I get to 2, he updates the next segment, which is A5 colon colon 0, the original destination, but he doesn't route on it because it would create a loop. He forwards to the neighbor 4 according to the function encoded in A2 colon colon C4. When it gets to 4, naturally the shortest path to A5 colon colon 0 is 2.5, and we have implemented a fast reroute technique. So this is one of the first use cases for applying SRv6 in the underlay. The second one, I'm going to skip it because I need to focus on the overlay VPN and the NFV, but I think you're going to understand it by intuition. If I can do fast reroute across any topology, it means I'm doing a traffic engineering operation for my backup path. And so I can do traffic engineering as well with SRv6, so I'm going to skip this use case. You have it in the draft and you have it as well here. And you have a recording on our website, which is public, of a presentation that I did 2 weeks ago. So let me now focus on the VPN. Because I think that the underlay is quite obvious with fast reroute and T. So applying SRv6 for the underlay is obvious, but we want to have this bold thing of doing anything with SRv6. How can I do VPN? Well, I have a tenant. I have two tenants connected to PE number 1 and 2. And PE number 2 is going to signal via BGP, hey, I know about this route V/64 in the VPN green. What is the next stop? I can simply put A2 colon colon C4. That's it. I have conveyed that actually 1 to reach V/64 is via A2 colon colon C4. It's true. A2 is the locator to node 2. And at node 2, the function C4 means cross-connect 2.4. So from a data plane viewpoint, that's obvious. I receive a packet, and all what I need to do is push another header. No segment routing extension header because I have a single segment, so I don't need it here. The outer header is sufficient. So in this outer header, I put my single segment, A2 colon colon C4. This is going to be routed through an IPv6 a plain backbone, so I don't need any SRv6 upgrade anywhere, only on the PEs where I deploy this technology. And when I get to 2, 2 says it's me, C4 means cross-connect 2.4, he pops the header and he forwards this. And it works for IPv4, it works for IPv6, it works for layer 2. Pablo has coded this in open source, FDIO. You can go in at the booth at the MPLS SDN workshop, or we can contact us, and we can do the demonstration. So it's real. So what do we learn from this? It's automated. You don't have to configure any tunnel. It is simple because we eliminate GRE, L2TP V3, UDP, VXLAN, and all the possible encapsulation you have in mind. You just need to convey a segment, which is the network instruction, go there and execute that cross-connect function. And then it's efficient because obviously we reuse always the same constructs for more things, but as well it's efficient from a routing viewpoint because the extension we need to do in BGP is straightforward. The draft that I show there is 6 pages long. The extension in BGP to do this is obvious. We don't need to reboil everything. Not only we can simplify by eliminating, but we can also do things that others cannot do. We can do overlay with integrated underlay control. So let me go through this. And that's why I skipped the TE part, because we're going to see again TE in action here. If I have my two sites in the green VPN, P number 2 is going to signal, hey, I know about V/64, come to me, A2 colon colon C4. That's what we saw before. And we can already we're shipping this and we've deployed this with MPLS. So again, it's always the same thought process, is that if we can do it with MPLS, we can, as soon as we have the data plane for SRv6, it will be applicable to SRv6 as well. And so here, the only thing we need to do is to color the BGP route. And we put a community to say, hey, that route is premium. It should come back to me, A2 column column C4, not via ISIS best effort route, but via a premium, for example, in this case, low latency path. So when one receives this VPN route, he says, my next stop is 2, but with low latency. So on demand, BGP calls to TE, segment routing T, and he says, how can I go to 2 low latency? SRT says, I take care of it, and on demand, he generates a segment routing policy, which means he computes on demand on the basis of the topology how to go from 1 to 2 in a low latency way. And it's not, let's say, the middle path. It finds out that it needs to go via router number 3. So it's going to use a segment 3 that goes through the locator 3 and a simple endpoint function, the function 0. And so that's it. When the packet is going to be received by 1, he sees that it's going to V, and so it's going to encapsulate in another header with the segment routing extension header, because now we need 2 segments. The first segment is A3 column column 0. It's put in the destination address, and it forwards the packet to node 3 on the low latency path. When node 3 receives it, he says, it's me. Function 0 means almost do nothing. Take the next segment, A2 column column C4, put it in the destination address, routes according to A2 column column C4. So finally, the packet gets to 2, and 2 says, ah, it's me. Cross connect 2.4, pop, and that's it. We have a VPN with integrated SLA. So it's not that we were efficient. It's not that we were eliminating other protocols. This VXLAN, they cannot do. GRE, they cannot do. Any encapsulation, they cannot do. Here, because it's the same underlay and overlay solution, we can integrate these different requirements in a seamless manner. And all is automated. And if you want to see a demonstration, we can already demonstrate this. How much time do I have?
Finish.
Ah, okay, so I skip spray. The only thing I'm going to say is Prey is our first deployed use case for SRv6, likely at Comcast. This it's in trial right now, so I think it's going to be deployed certainly in calendar year 17. I can say it because John Leddy at Comcast spoke on this publicly in June 2016 at a joint conference, so I skip it. I'm going just to say this, and I let you contact us or ask for a demo. We will demonstrate this at MPLS SDN World Congress this week. It's the integration of the underlay SLA that I just described, the overlay VPN with NFV. And skipping through the step-by-step demo, I think you have already understood that we can, on a server, bind a segment to a container. We can, on a server, bind a segment to a VM. And so if I want to forward a packet in a VPN context through a service chain, I simply need to list the segments that are associated with the underlay SLA, with the overlay VPN, with the NFV. And this is not, let's say, dreaming. We have done this both already on Linux and FDIO, two open source implementation that we demonstrate this week. So Pablo and Francois are working on the FDIO. And Stefano is in the room. Stefano is going to present next. And this is a fantastic collaboration with Stefano. We started this in September, so we are, it's like segment running, very, very fast. And so very proud for Stefano to already demonstrate this on Linux. So it's also a commitment to our lead operators to show that we support this ecosystem because it's on two open source implementation. So let me conclude. So a bit of a promotion for the local teams here. There are more use cases. Here in Paris, we have different teams focusing, for example, on video distribution or on ICN type of technique like 6CN. But as well, they have invented enhanced load balancers. We don't have the time to go over this, but expect more communication as we go through this year and we disclose more and more of the use case. And know that these people are here, so Pierre is there, for example. Don't hesitate to, and Mark, to contact them for a bit more information. There are obvious applications in 5G, obviously. So, conclusion, obviously it's a bold architecture. We know it's bold, so I think we have a lot of humility. We had this very long meeting in January with the lead operators, with the lead member of the academic team to review all of this. It was intense. We submitted on time all the documents to the ITF. We had immediate buy-in from other vendors in order to get a consensus. I know that some of these other vendors are already working on the implementation, so we're going to see that it's not only Cisco. It's not only Cisco and open source that we are funding, but it's also a healthy ecosystem, so I think we are proud of this. And I will finish by this. The lead operators are the only thing that makes this possible, so it's extremely important. We have a lot of commitment to them, but it also means if you are in the room, you're interested, you have use case, please tell us. It's very important to work together and have your use case, your feedback, your question, etc. Thank you.
Thank you for that very energetic, powerful overview. One question, because we're running out of time. Marcus.
Regarding the VPN cross-connect segment, it seems to be analogous to the per CE label. What do you do if you have multiple CEs? How does it handle that?
So the question is, it looks very similar to some of the VPN construct in MPLS VPN. First, absolutely, it's modeled like this. When you have a good idea, why boil the ocean? Just reuse it and apply it in a seamless manner. So first, the model, for those who know MPLS VPN, is going to be that easy. Then how do you do it? Then it's very easy. If I have hundreds of different CEs,
then I'm basically going to have hundreds of functions. From a network viewpoint, it's easy because they only route on the locator block, which is the /64. Nobody knows. But when it comes to me, the EGRESP, it's only me who understand what I put as a function ID. And in the function ID, I will have put the function ID that reminds me if it's a per VERF or a per CE, a per link allocation cross-connect. So it's really straightforward. So
presumably then you're going to have to do something like best external and advertise multiple. Right.
Yeah, but this we already did for MPLS VPN, so we reuse this. Yeah. You see, it's always this thing we reuse. There's the only thing we need to do is this: add this little attribute to convey the segment with the BGP route. That's the only thing we define in the draft. Like if you look at MPLSSR, we did a little extension, very little extension to the routing protocol. We simply used these routing protocols correctly.
Thank you, Clarence.